Hey, everyone. Hello, Nirvana. All right. Hi, everyone. Thank you for tuning in because this is such an important moment for the world to come together. We all know about the absolute devastation in the earthquakes in Turkey and Syria. They've already taken the lives of 41,000 people. That number is going up every day. There are tens of thousands of people who have been injured. Over a million people in Turkey and 5.3 million people in Syria are homeless. Those numbers are absolutely hard to comprehend, and I know our hearts go out to everyone affected. But people do not just need our hearts, they need our help. And that is where this conversation comes in. I'm here with CARE, one of the unbelievable organizations helping Turkish and Syrian families survive, delivering humanitarian aid. I had a chance to visit you. I visited your programs on the ground. I know how amazing they are. And I'm so honored that Nirvana, CARE's regional director for Middle East and North Africa, invited me to have this talk with her. Because I know, Nirvana, you are working around the clock right now. And this is a chance for us to show people and tell people what you're doing. So hopefully they can jump in and help. But thank you for taking the time to talk to me today.
Thank you. Thank you, Cheryl, for having me. And it's an absolute pleasure to meet you today and to meet your followers. And yeah, I mean, it's been a devastating few days now. I mean, it's the 12th day of after the earthquake, and everyone is just grappling with the reality. This is the biggest humanitarian natural disaster that we have seen in the Middle East in 100 years. And I think that this is actually the biggest earthquake that we hear of in our lifetime to that magnitude. I think that the only event, I mean, crisis event that we can compare to is the tsunami a decade ago. And so the devastation is massive. The numbers are heartbreaking, and the footage that is coming from the ground is
so horrific. I want to start with the most basic question.
Thank you so much for having me
today. How are you today? How are the people you're helping, and how is your staff? Because this is obviously such a life-altering situation for everyone involved.
It is. The colleague have woke up at 4 a.m. 12 days ago to an earthquake. I think that the magnitude of the earthquake is 7.8 Richter, but it was not just about the magnitude, it was also the length of the earthquake. It lasted for almost 2 hours. And this was totally, I mean, the destruction that has left and impacted is unbelievable. Our team are holding up. I mean, it's a unique moment of time where first responders and humanitarian aid professionals are actually the ones who are in need of assistance and the ones who are losing shelter. And for many days, people sheltered in their cars in the street with their young kids. Very sadly, we also lost two colleagues to the earthquake. Anas in Turkey, and Mohammed in Northwest Syria, and so many other colleagues have lost their family members, have lost their friends, have lost many of their loved ones. So it is very difficult to say we are fine. I mean, everyone is really just struggling to get their head around the realities that they have lost their homes, they have lost their loved ones, they are out in the streets, and they are the ones who are trying to find shelter for their children, and in the same time they are still standing on for their commitment and obligation to be first responders and to provide assistance to their community and to the people they serve. So it's a heroic effort. And yeah, I mean,
it is definitely
everyone
effort.
is holding on.
Some of the things CARE is doing, the emergency aid, the actual work on the ground. I think people need to understand how the very basics, food, shelter, water, are so difficult to provide in a situation with devastation this broad.
Exactly. Sure, sure. So the devastation is going across, I mean, southeast Turkey and northwest Syria. So this is where most of the devastation is. And our colleagues have gathered shortly after the crises to organize themselves, getting out the assistance that people need. We are providing, I mean, the whole, I would say the whole package of life-saving assistance of providing warm clothes, clean water, milk for children, medicines, and tents, of course, and blankets, and the list continues. And of course, above all that, we as CARE, we actually work a lot on providing also, I mean, on providing wash materials, so hygiene kits, dignity kits, clean water trucks, and so on. So yeah, it is across the board. It is really of a very large scale. And right before I spoke to you, I actually had a chat with my team on the ground, and they have given me so much amazing data of just the assistance that they were able to deliver in just less than a week. So yeah, let me just read it to you, because it is impossible to remember how amazing it is. So in northwest Syria, they have provided, again, in just few days after the earthquake, they have provided non-food items to 25,000 people. Wash, as in clean water and hygiene kits and dignity kits, to 62,000 people, and shelters and just debris removals and all the basic shelter assistance to 83,000 people. So this is in total, just in northwest Syria, they have reached 170,000 people, which makes, I mean, more than 43,000 families. Again, this is just in a few days. In Turkey, the initial response have reached out also to, I mean, with winter clothes, with heaters, with hygiene kits, with clean water. And I have to tell you, I mean, the products are really running out off the shelves very quickly. So we were very fortunate to have had a lot of stock, because we were working on the Syrian crisis for the last decade, providing humanitarian assistance to the people in Syria. And so we had a lot of these materials in stock, but of course the needs are much more massive than that. And our team in Turkey have so far to today have reached 30,000 families, 30,000 households, and the numbers are rising up.
All of this is happening, particularly in northwest Syria, on top of people who have lived, you know, in really unimaginable conditions for the last 12 years. So this is not happening in a region, part of it is happening where you were already working so hard to provide resources people need. When this happens for Northwest Syria, on top of what is already so much devastation, how does that impact your ability to deliver the services people need?
As I mentioned, we have been working on the Syrian crisis and in northwest Syria, and actually in the whole northern Syria. And so we have a team on the ground that we are very, very proud of their heroic actions, in addition to Syrian partner organizations operating on the ground. And when the earthquake hit, this was what you can call it, a perfect storm. More than a decade, almost 12 years of war and conflict, and people displaced from all across Syria. I mean, in northwest Syria alone, there are, I think the numbers are 4.6 million people living there. 60% of them are displaced from all across the country. So they have left their villages or their small towns in seek of safety in northwest Syria. 60%. And this 60% is mostly living in camps, in informal settlements, in very, very difficult, harsh conditions. So CARE has been already providing a lot of assistance to the community in Northwest Syria for the longest of time, and it really varied from providing shelter and providing livelihood supports, and also supporting women who have been struggling the most in these conditions to get livelihoods. And yeah, and adding to that, just in the last few years. So it's the continued situation of war. It's the continued situation of displacement and massive humanitarian needs. Then came a COVID crisis that hit the whole world. But as you can imagine, particularly in Syria, where it is very, very prone and vulnerable, it hit in multiplied times. Adding to that, and I don't know, I mean, if this was out in the news in the US or not, but actually since the fall, since September, there was cholera outbreak that has broke out in northern Syria, and there is an extreme winter that we are seeing this year. That just a few days before the earthquake, there was a massive snowstorm that has basically shut down the whole area, and now the earthquake. So it's the level of devastation is something that we have not experienced before, and looking into actually the efforts, the heroic efforts that are in regards of removing rubbles, mm-hmm. and cleaning up, and I mean it has not even covered 10% of the damage. There are so many villages and small towns that have been completely wiped out from the face of earth, and the number of people who have sadly lost their lives in Northwest Syria alone from the 10% that actually took out the rubble so far is close to 5,000 people. So it is yeah. unimaginable.
So you talked about women and girls, and you and I both know one of the reasons I do so much work with care and support care is that you always remember and understand that in any of these situations where it's regular economic hardship, whether it's war, whether it's conflict, whether it's a devastating crisis, women and girls in many ways are often hit the hardest. How do you think this will impact women and girls in this region?
Yeah. To be very honest, in every crisis situation, everyone is impacted without distinction, I would say. However, the most ones who actually get the most negative impacts of the crises are usually the most vulnerable of the community, and of course women and girls are the most vulnerable. So we're looking here at a very prolonged, protracted conflict where a lot of families and households have shifted role, have lost their father, have lost their male provider, and a lot of women became the heads of the households and became the main providers for their families. So you can imagine, of course, in this situation, how these women will be grappling with finding livelihoods for their kids and for their extended family, because a lot of these families also are extended families of so many, added further members of the family as cousins and extended family. Adding to that, women and girls are the most vulnerable in regards of being prone to abuse, being prone to a lot of risks on the ground. And so we in CARE have, because we, I mean, you know CARE very well. I mean, we focus, I mean, our work around ensuring that women and girls are in the forefront of our responses and our programming. And so, for example, when we are looking now at the first wave of response and the shelters that are needed to host these, displaced communities, one of the first things that we are thinking of is how to create safe spaces for women and girls. how to create also systems for case management for women and girls who are victims to gender-based violence. How are we providing also maternal assistance and for hospitals or for clinics, and how we are providing support, for example, to lactating mothers and so on. So these are all different layers of our considerations when we design our programming to ensure that we are putting, I mean, the women and girls, their protection, their safety, and their well-being and dignity.
It's also important. I think you and I have spoken about it. I've certainly spent a lot of time talking to Michelle Nunn, the CARE CEO, about this, is that it's not just the emergency shelters cause issues where women can suffer violence, right? We need increased safety, but it's also that this exacerbates the long-term trend. So in the last year, I got married. And rather than get wedding gifts, and as part of celebrating my wedding, my husband and I made a substantial commitment, and our friends and family joined us to CARE's program, which programs against child marriage. And child marriage, you know, marrying off your daughter, not because you want to, but because you feel like you have no choice, at a very young age, where she becomes in every way subservient to usually a much older man. She loses everything. Her education, her freedom, her sexual control of her own life. I mean, she loses everything.
Yeah.
These situations exacerbate that. So it's not just the work you're doing now. We want everyone to remember that after this, there's the emergency phase right now, but after this, there will be the ongoing devastation, which exacerbates some of these long-term trends we're fighting. And I'm just so glad, Nirvana, you run an amazing organization across this region that we're there. So last question. There are so many people who sit, watch, are helpless, don't know what to do. What can the global community do to help the people who are impacted by this?
Sure. There are so many things that can be done. And allow me to start by, I mean, saying the obvious. It's the resourcing. It is the funding. It is the reality that a lot of these crises need the international community solidarity and support, and the funding here. And again, I mean, I know that I might be saying the obvious, but the reality is that our world is full of crises everywhere, and so we need to ensure that whenever there is commitments and pledges to support certain crises, that they are not actually taking away from a different crisis, because it's all over. This is one thing. The other thing that is also very important is to ensure that, and I know that a lot of our, I mean, esteemed donors and supporters are watching you and are following you. And I think my key message is please, please, please. I mean, we need to ensure that there is actually extended duration of fundings. A lot of the government donors that you asked me about earlier were actually, I mean, provide very short term assistance, and it is very difficult to work on longer term support programs to really change people's lives, to really give them hope. If we are looking at very short term cycles of few weeks, so this is something that is very, very important. I think that the other thing that is also, and this is actually for everyone who's watching us, just the general support that you can provide to us. I mean, any support will be very, very valuable in saving someone's life from the cold or providing milk to a young child. And yeah, I mean, we are in CARE, we are collecting support and donations, and we would be very, very appreciative if you can help us as well fundraise to support the people who are in massive needs, both in Turkey.
Nirvana, thank you for your time today. Thank you for your leadership of an incredible team on the ground. We're with you. We will support you. And we are lucky to have the people like you and the teams you represent stepping up in these moments. You are, it's an honor to be with you this morning.
Thank you, Cheryl. Thank you so much. It's an absolute pleasure, and have a safe and good day. Thank